Αγνή Παρθένε Δέσποινα, αχράντε Θεοτόκε.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Orthodox Logos. My name is Ian Silver, and today I'm joined by Mark Ratelle. Some of you guys may know him from YouTube with his alias Ratelle. He's always in the live chats. If you've been in any of my videos or A Devotional Hearts, Jay Dyer, David Patrick Harry, kind of floating around in there a little bit. But he's an Orthodox catechumen, a film aficionado, which is epic. I love that. Creator of VHS Wildlife Preserve, which is a VHS group on Facebook with over 2,000 members. He is a husband and a loving father. So I'm excited to have you, Mark. And, you know, thanks for taking the time to be here after our minor tech issues, boomer tech. Right.
Yeah. Hopefully there's no more on my end, but
we should be okay.
I'll be upgrading my tech here shortly as well. So I'm looking forward to that.
Well, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen. Truly, brother. Yeah.
Yes. So it's been a good couple weeks, and I guess we can just kind of get into it. I was asking you prior what the whole wildlife preserve VHS group thing is, because when you first sent me that you did VHS, I mean, I know what a VHS is. I used to collect them, like the old ones, just to watch with my kid, but I was kind of confused. I was like, this is a thing?
It kind of like threw you off, huh?
Yeah. So it's a thing. Yeah, no, people collect
it's
them.
It's super, it's become trendy all of a sudden. I got into it. I used to work at a video store back in like 2012-ish kind of time period. I was working at a video store called Blowout DVD.
Oh, great.
And yeah. From there, I would get DVDs for like a dollar a pop, and I got let go from that spot, and I ended up finding another local video store called Kensington Video, and in the back they had this like hidden VHS tape area that was kind of like, it was just like this treasure trove for a film aficionado or whatever you want to call it, you know. But it was awesome for me because it was only 50 cents a pop, and it was all these weird movies, just weird obscure old cinema from the 70s and 80s, B movies, all kinds of stuff. And that's kind of where my love for VHS kind of got rekindled from my childhood.
Yeah,
I started collecting
a big wall of them there.
Yeah. I got a lot. I got too many. There's a lot going on here. I have like 10,000.
Do you really?
Yeah, I do.
So there's
like
a lot.
Boxes all over here, like outside of the, it's just boxes of tapes. It's mad.
How's your wife like that?
She hates it. You know, she hates it.
Yeah, that's kind of cool. Yeah. And I'm kind of, I think you've probably noticed I've been selling some books. I'm kind of.
Yeah, I've noticed, man. You have some pretty cool looking books there, actually.
Yeah, so I can relate with you, but also it's like I just picked up this little, I guess you could call it a gig, at the library, the town over, where every week I'll go in and help the old ladies move stuff. And I kind of like with you, I get to be in the back room and see stuff before it comes in. And I know if I'm paying a dollar for a book that's worth $100, my 2 hours of volunteer time is worth it.
Yeah, definitely. So, yeah, no, I used to help the owner, guy of Kensington Video. We'd come every Tuesday morning, me and my buddy Danny, help him move in the boxes and get like first dibs. It was just such a cool experience being part of that culture right at the tail end of it before it shut down, because there's none of those places left now.
There's like one Blockbuster, I think, right?
In like Portland, Ohio, Oregon, or something like that. Yeah. And I think that one's might be on the verge of shutting down too. I wouldn't be surprised. So
crazy.
Yeah.
So do you, are you able to like resell these things, or what is
Oh,
your,
yeah, no, I actually see, here's the thing. There's now there's a market for sealed VHS tapes are like booming right now on eBay. I ended up selling a Street Fighter sealed tape for $600 a couple months back.
What'd you pay for it?
Like 10 cents.
Yeah. Right? I love it. That's great. Yeah. It's like, I used to sell vintage cameras too. So I'm very familiar with the type of lifestyle. And that's where I wanted to ask you just about the name. Like, you were telling me the Wildlife preserve, which I was thinking, okay, this has to do with like animals, but you were explaining that's something different.
Well, yeah, no, it was almost like a play on words there. I used to be like really into hip hop and MCing and freestyling and all that. So it was kind of like a play on words. And I was really into that at the time, like VHS wildlife. And it's also like a double meaning because then hunting in the wild, like drifting, and then preserving tapes. But then it's almost also like wildlife preserve. I don't know.
Yeah, I like it. Some linguistics there.
Yeah, yeah. I was playing.
So are you going to spit something for us? No, I'm just kidding.
Oh, no. No, I'm not spitting anything. Not live.
Okay, good.
I'll send you some of my old freestyles on my old channel. I'm a little rusty right now.
Cool.
I'm a little rusty, but.
Yeah. But also, you're a catechumen. When did you, I guess we'll get into, you know, some of the background of things.
Yeah.
When did you find the church? What is your upbringing? Kind of walk us through that a little bit.
Totally. So I was raised Catholic. My mother was a devout Catholic. I used to walk to Catholic school and to Catholic church to her before I even went to school every day. We would walk like a couple miles to St. John of the Cross.
Wow.
In Lemon Grove. So we would go there. Like super devout, my mother. And I started going to Catholic school from preschool to sixth grade was my last year at Catholic school at St. John of the Cross. And I was baptized as a baby. I was baptized by Father Jerry, his name was. And I think he prophesied to my mother that I was going to be like the next John the Baptist. I don't know about all that. You know, yeah. I haven't lived up to that one yet. I don't think I'm going to. But, you know, it was interesting. And he was very... He was a cool priest from what I hear. And so, yeah, I went there, but I was very devout at the beginning. And then I always had issues with the theology. I had issues. And then later on, it made a lot more sense coming into Orthodoxy. Like a lot of those puzzle pieces really started coming together as far as like, at that time, I didn't understand papal infallibility or even what that was, but I knew something was up. I was like, man, this dude's got a lot of like power and like, you know, and And I was, and then there was certain aspects of confession where it felt like I was doing it to the priest. And then when I found out how confession worked in Orthodoxy, I was like, man, this is perfect. Like, this is the way it should be. And I was like, oh, this is the way it was before it was changed. I was like, oh, okay. And it's just interesting to find those things out and really put those puzzle pieces together where as a child, even instinctually, even wanting to be devout, wanting to believe, I was like, man, something's up here, something's off. And then finding that later on coming to Orthodoxy, really putting those, having it all come together. It was just really beautiful. And the first way that I came to it was through Kotel, was through Church of Eternal Logos.
Shout out David Patrick Harry.
Yeah, shout out to him, man. I mean, yeah, I basically had come back from a very high dose mushroom ceremony with my wife. It was like a 15 gram ceremony on native land with natives. And It was insane. It was like spiritual warfare 100%.
Do you want to get into that? Should we get into that now?
We can get into that. Yeah.
Or do you think it's worth kind of taking that after we talk about your finding the faith? What do you think? Because I mean, I guess it is how you found the faith.
Honestly, that's how I found it though.
Yeah. So let's go.
Yeah. Because it's like, so I mean, I started out with like, I guess first, one of the first things I came to after falling away from Catholicism was Buddhism.
Same here.
And I read The Art of Happiness by the Dalai Lama. And
there's like the four agreements and.
Yeah. I came into that and it was just like, I think it got me with like the reverse psychology. It was like totally, I think the Dalai Lama at the beginning, he said something like, if this doesn't apply to your life, totally disregard it. And if it does, then apply it. And I was like such a rebel at the time. I was like, oh yeah. This must be true then, right? He's just like,
sounds right.
Yeah, it just felt right. It felt so good, you know? And it was that's what I was in that stage of just wanting to be told something nice and pretty and sweet. And it told me a lot of that. And I didn't go too deep into that, but it just helped me through. I thought it helped me through a rough period. I was reading that. And I actually appreciate every point that I went through because it helps me gain more clarity just seeing all the how it's all so similar.
Yeah,
there's a lot of similar spirits in the New Age and in all these different religions. And then from there, I went to Kundalini Yoga and Hinduism, and I was super deep, like super duper deep into that. I did that for about 10 years. I started out doing this introductory class like every day.
What, like Ashtanga?
I was doing this beginner's class with it was Sarah Klein introductory class, just introduction to Kundalini yoga. And I was doing that. It was like a 50 minute class, kind of basic. And I was just kind of like mastering that for a while. And then I started doing refill yoga. It was Kundalini yoga through refill yoga was the name. And there was a lot of classes in that, there was a wide range of different yoga practices within that. And I was just doing it online, but yeah. I was deep into it. I was very deep into it. And early on, I actually had what they refer to as a blue pearl experience, where you're imagining, where you're doing a breathing exercise, a very deep breathing exercise, and focusing your energy into your third eye. And I saw a blue orb of energy come into my third eye, basically. And I felt like a surge of energy come to my body.
That's called a demon.
Yeah, definitely. 100%. 100% demonic. Don't do this. I don't recommend doing this at all. Like, just so you guys know, like, I'm just describing what I was going through, from the perspective I was in at the time. And it affected me deeply, because I at the time I was agnostic and I didn't really believe in God at all. So
just the universe or.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I was kind of I was just the only thing I know for sure is that I don't know anything at all.
That was my motto.
That was my motto at the time.
That's a very like Zen Buddhist approach to life.
Yeah, exactly. So that's where I was at. But honestly,
it also does. I mean, it makes sense. Like we don't know anything, but that's not the only thing that we know.
Right.
So it's like they trick you with these words and these slogans and you're like, oh yeah.
There may be a sliver of truth in it, but it's like ultimately it usually leads you in a self-destructive cycle.
Well, that's how the devil works. He gives you he's working on half truths.
Exactly.
Like, you can find that everywhere you go. And then, like you said, whenever you discovered Orthodox, you're like, putting the puzzle pieces together. And another thing I wanted to say about even at a young age, recognizing it, it's like our childlike innocence and just like our childlike tendencies to recognize things that are inherently good and bad is so much more prevalent than like when we get older, because we're just, you know, we're bombarded by all these things that our senses are kind of like, you know, blocked from the truth. But when you're a kid, you kind of just know.
I think it's like, well, the untainted news.
Yeah.
Right.
Exactly.
And then come into Orthodoxy, just that. And I used to always talk about, like, there was points later on when coming into like lower levels of Christianity, what I considered to be like kind of rising up into when I came to what I believe to be the original church, Orthodoxy. It's interesting. What were we talking? What was I saying again? I lost my train of thought there.
Well, the last thing we were on was the blue sphere.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let's go back to that.
Yeah, we can go back to that.
So
you had this experience.
I had that experience. Another interesting thing to note though, is the logos spermaticos aspect of Orthodoxy, where you can find these slivers of truth and it can explain it from an Orthodox perspective, the way Justin Martyr did, but that ultimately the fulfillment of that truth is Orthodoxy.
Yeah.
Coming to find that later on. But the blue sphere, I had that experience. It affected me. It changed me from a person who was like, maybe God exists, to definitely something exists. I thought I experienced something divine in that moment. Come to find out, it was something demonic later on—a fallen angel, not a risen angel.
Yeah.
So that experience affected me deeply. I went on to keep practicing yoga for a long time. It like really actually invigorated my practice.
It
fed into my ego. It fed my ego is really what it fed.
Yeah, because you felt like you got something out of it. Finally.
Yeah. Yeah. And it happened very early on too. So that also fed into my ego. And I stuck with that for a long time. And then I started getting into psychedelics. I started doing these walks with a local group. It was a veterans group. And we started doing these walks. And it was presented in a very healing manner, you know, like healing PTSD. I don't have any veteran background aspects or anything, but I was looking for healing, and I was very into the new age at the time. And I was like, this might be the culmination of my practice of my Kundalini. You know what I mean? I felt like I was led here. I was very into like synchronicities and astro theology, Santo Spinacci. Like I was deep down the rabbit hole.
Bro. Yeah.
Like, I mean, all of it, you know, all of it, anything but Christ, basically anything, but like just basic Christianity. I was just, but I had been repelled from Catholicism and kind of a watered down Western Christianity, which a lot of us, I feel like, have been repelled from, and yeah. even rightfully so to some aspect, right?
Yeah.
And that's why I kind of try to relate to some of these people in similar walks of life. I try to relate to them like, bro, I get it.
Yeah, Western Christianity.
Into orthodoxy, right? Yeah, no, it has.
Exactly. Yeah, I agree. It's like you said, rightfully so. It's like we wonder why people turn away from Christianity. It's because it's the Christianity that they're being taught is not Christianity.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So yeah, the New Age is I lived in Sedona. I'm sure you know that, or you might have heard it. So it's like peak.
Very prevalent there, right?
Peak woo-woo, charging your crystals, singing bowls, full moon drum circles. I mean, the whole thing. So I was a really, really good yogi, like very, very deep into it. I didn't do much of the Kundalini stuff. I did like Ashtanga or just like vinyasa flows.
Gotcha.
But like really crazy stuff, like touch my toes to my head, full scorpion, like
right.
Crazy.
Yeah, I wasn't very flexible. I was into like the deep breathing exercises, and I was just trying to get,
Mine was purely ego based. Like, look what I can do. Look what I can
exactly
do.
Right. Look what I can do. Yeah, yeah.
And look where that got
like,
me.
It's funny because I realized the things I was doing, like even at the higher levels, it's just like it's demons mocking me. I was like a demon mocking me through my action, and it was like, it's so crazy to look back and see myself like crossing my eyes to like try to meet my pineal gland. And I'm like, I look so ridiculous. Like, what was I doing?
Thumbnail for the video.
Right. You know? Oh, man.
So
but it's crazy.
So after you had that experience and you continued practicing yoga and doing all the New Age stuff, where did that lead you? You started doing psychedelics.
That led me to, microdosing. And I had an experience about 10 years back where I did some mushrooms and I felt like I was dying, and I actually turned purple, not like hallucinating that I was purple, but I was with someone else who didn't take any, and I was actually purple, and I felt like I was dying, and I was cold to the touch. And, I don't know why I came back to it from, I felt like I wanted to conquer that for some reason. Mm-hmm. I felt like I had to conquer it. That was my mentality, which wasn't, I don't recommend
any
of this.
Like that showed you a sign of weakness, and you were like, I need to do it again and not be weak.
Exactly. That was my thought process at the time. I was like, I need to conquer this. I need to somehow. So I started coming back to it, and, I had, I guess what you could call more positive experiences, which were just 100% demonic, actually. Yeah.
Just tripping out really hard.
Yeah, I was tripping. Actually, I thought I was visited by one of my deceased friends. I thought I had visitation from a deceased friend, which was a demon in disguise. When you come to read more Orthodox theology and realize what's really happening, and then be like, wow, that sounds a lot like what I experienced. And did I test the spirit? No, I didn't test the spirit, of course.
And you welcomed the spirit, which allowed more to come in.
Exactly. And it just, everything that happened led me into... I'll explain what culminated on that night of the ceremony.
Yeah.
But I had some 5G, alone in the dark, kind of like through the middle of the night experiences. That was when I had a visitation. And then I kept going on these walks, and eventually I came into contact with this group. It was a church out on native land in correlation with this veterans group. And there was a ceremony held with about maybe 17 people, all men, except for my wife.
Peyote or mescaline?
No, this was a high dose mushroom ceremony, 15 grams.
Oh, so the hero dose?
Yeah. Super heroic dose. And so we went out there for that, and we were gathering sage and going around the land and having all these experiences leading up to the night. And the ceremony started around 9 p.m. and we would come into the Womkish, and it's like it's got these posts, and you walk in and you walk this way, you walk clockwise, you walk always clockwise around the fire.
There's some symbology there.
Yeah, definitely. And so we sat around in a circle. There's a fire in the center, and there's a big pot of just tons of mushrooms, and we ended up holding out our hands, and it was about, the mushrooms were like my hands full of mushrooms. I've never taken anything near that in my life. You know, I've done the 5G dose, but nothing like this. Me and my wife both did the full 15 grams. So we take that. About 45 minutes in or so, it starts kicking in. My wife looks up and she looks at the sky and she's like, "Is there star? Are the stars gone?" And it seemed like the stars had disappeared. Like the sky was just pitch black.
So it's an open top.
It's an open top, but it's closed around the sides except for one walkway, and then a fire in the center, and then like a chief kind of leading the ceremony. Other natives there and mostly veterans.
Are these like?
These are real natives.
Yeah, so this is like a legit. This isn't like.
It's pretty legit. We're on native land. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, but it's young people. But it's young folks, and they're like 20.
Oh, dude.
Some of them are like leading it in like their 20s, 28-ish.
They start doing peyote very early.
Yeah, no, he has experience. They had experience in that realm too, leading up to that. So,
yeah.
You know, they were legit as they could be for that, for where we were and for their age, I would say.
Yeah.
And so yeah.
She looks up. The stars gone.
The stars have disappeared. She says, we're in a portal. And it felt like we were in a portal. Like we opened up a portal. We just didn't know we opened up a portal to what I believe to be hell.
Yeah.
Or some just an opening for demonic spirits to come through. Because shortly after, there was an older gentleman to the right of us. And he stood up and he started like moving like a gremlin. Almost like the dude from the Lord of the Rings. It was so disturbing to see, and he started moving around like in this demonic just, and he's making these demonic sounds and grunting. And
this was real, or this wasn't part of the.
This was not a hallucination, because I was almost asking my wife too. I was like, you saw that too, right? Like,
yeah.
And it wasn't a hallucination. I could tell the difference even on that high of a dose. It was easy to determine what was, at least at first. It got into a place where I didn't know reality from fantasy. And that was later on in the night.
So you got this dude crawling around like Gollum.
Yeah, we got this dude going around like Gollum from Lord of the Rings. And it's tripping me out. And I'm like, okay, just focus on yourself. Focus on the fire. That's what they told me.
You know, breathe. So
I'm staying, breathe, right? Do your kundalini, bro.
Yeah.
Just kundalini it all the way through, you know? And I really was. I was doing my breathing exercises, all that nonsense, focusing on the fire. And so we tough it out, dude. We're out there till like maybe 2 a.m. ish or so. And the ceremony wraps up. We're just sitting around the fire and kind of observing. And we told our intentions beforehand. I think my intentions were to tap into source. And I wanted to work.
That word.
Yeah, I know, dude. That's my mentality at the time. Like I had the what was it? Quartz crystal around my neck, quartz crystal necklace. Yeah. And there was weird things going on with that night, even. Like it felt like it's so hot, I had to take it off my chest. And I don't think it was from the fire. It felt like it was energies, just like it was crazy. It was an intense night, the most intense night of my entire life. And so we go inside, the ceremony's wrapping up. They put out the fire, we go inside, but there was weird tension throughout the night. They were making like weird comments, like as they were putting out the fire. Yeah. Like the Indian dude, as he was putting out the fire behind me with the hose, he was saying, like, he got some water on me. I was just sitting there kind of meditating still. And he was like, oh, I'm just pissing on you. Don't worry about it. It was like, it was just kind of weird, because I'm like there with my wife, you know?
Yeah.
And it was just weird, weird vibes. You start getting weird vibes. And I'm like, man, maybe this isn't as holy of a thing as I thought it was. And you start, there was other things throughout the night.
Those little comments, it's like,
yeah,
that's not something that should be happening during a sacred ritual.
Exactly. I was like, maybe
it's not the language that you use.
Yeah, no, because I really prepared for this thing. Like I'd fasted from like sexual activity with my wife for like a month. Like I really took all this stuff serious. I thought
once again, legit. There's like those like slivers of truth. Like whenever you go do heavy doses of anything like ayahuasca or mushroom chips, it's like you fast, you don't have sex. You do all these things to lead up to this experience. And it's like,
yeah.
we do the same thing, but we do it in a truly holy manner, you know, to connect with God, not source. Source is like,
yeah.
Man, that word in Sedona.
Exactly.
People are like, yeah. Connecting with source. I'm like, no, you're connecting with demons. Yeah, because that goes
hand in hand with the universe too.
Yeah.
It's like, that's a piece of creation that resides under the creator. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
And it's like, and there was a lot of that at that ceremony. There was a lot of that, over giving too much reverence to creation, nature, Mother Nature, a lot of Mother Nature talk, and it stems from Mother Gaia worship and all these aspects that go deep into histories of paganism and all types of religions that have, you know.
Yeah, people are obsessed with I think the way to say it is we're in love with the invention and not the inventor.
Exactly.
It's like we're so like, you know, oh yeah, Mother Earth. It's like, well, who made Mother Earth?
Right.
You know, it's like a sub-creation type thing. Yeah. So okay. So sorry, I like to pick stuff apart. So wraps up. There's some things being said, the vibes are getting weird.
Yeah. And so we're heading into the house. My wife, she's having trouble. It's really hitting us at this point. We have a room to stay in the house. We're going into the room. We make a couple pit stops in the bathroom. And I'm like, I don't remember too much of this, honestly. I'm starting to black out. She's starting to have visions where she thinks she's Mary and I'm Joseph and our son Malachi, Jesus. I'm like, oh my God, this is blasphemy. We got to get out of here. Even then, I knew that was blasphemy. That wasn't right. I was like, oh, this is, even then I was like, oh no. I was like, we got to go. I was like, we're losing our minds here. And so they're trying to have us sleep in this room. But like after I heard that, I was like, oh, hells no. And plus I had this lingering feeling of sacrifice in the air. And I'm not saying they were going to sacrifice us, but I just felt like the spirit of sacrifice in the air lingering. It was weird. I didn't know how to explain
your
it.
Your soul.
Yeah.
You know,
I was sacrificing a piece of my soul that night.
You could have lost it all, man.
Yeah, no, totally. And it came to that shortly after. And so I pick her up and I'm taking her outside and I'm like, we got to go. And people think I'm like losing my mind. They're like, why are you dragging your wife outside? Like, she's trying to go to bed. It was just a mess at this point.
I can
imagine. It was hitting the fan, dude. Everything was hitting the fan. So there's a bunch of dudes on 15 grams that have like PTSD outside, kind of like wandering around. Some have went to bed. Some are still around the fire. There's like still a little bit of a fire going.
Not people that you want to upset in a moment like that.
Right. Yeah. And so there's a lot of tension. There's a lot of tension and there's people trying to calm me down. There's one dude that was doing well to calm me down in the moment. I couldn't really speak at this point. At this point, I lost my ability to speak. I was so far gone. And then I remember a demon voice in my head saying, I remember really feeling like I was in a portal of like, just this dark abyss where I was cut off from the love of God. Like if you've ever heard the Your Mate Tom interview with David Patrick Harry, dead on exactly the same thing I felt. I was like, oh man, that's what I felt totally. And I saw that right when I had come back from this experience. So back to the experience, I was totally cut off from God's love, it felt like. And I was stuck in this abyss and there was this voice in my head, this demonic voice saying the sun doesn't rise here like ever. Like you're just stuck here forever. There's no love, there's no happiness, there's no your son, there's no. And it was like, and then I started losing the memory of my son. Like it was being wiped clean from my head, my son Malachi. And I just started losing my mind, and I couldn't really tell anyone what was going on in that moment. And I remember getting up and being like, well, if this is gonna happen, I might as well just die. And I was like, the only way out of this is, I had this voice in my head telling me to jump in the fire. It's like, if you want to see your son again, just jump in the fire. So I get up and I howl at the moon like a wolf. Obviously, I was fighting a demon at the time, too.
Yeah,
it was demons just flowing all through the ceremony. I howl at the moon and I jump into the fire like I swan dive into the fire. And I lay there until a gentleman pulls me out. So he pulls me out. I wipe myself off and I'm like, surprised, almost like I came back to reality in that moment. I didn't know what was real and what wasn't even anymore. I couldn't tell the difference between reality and what I was tripping at that point. And I was like, oh my God, that's real. That was real. That's what I said.
Yeah, and I walked over. I really jumped into the fire.
Yeah, I really just jumped into a pit of flames, swan dove into it and laid there. It was insane. So I get out. And then one of the other gentlemen like really worked it. People are worked up at this point, of course. And
well, they're all tripping off. They're tripping hard.
Yeah. Well, there was a helper there who was
sober
off mushrooms. But I mean, no one was really sober there.
Yeah.
There was like 60 joints being passed around. It was ridiculous. Like the ceremony was, we were being smothered with joints during the ceremony. I didn't mention that part. It was like so many joints. It was ridiculous. I'd never seen so many joints in my life.
That's not going to help.
Yeah, it didn't help anything really. It was overwhelming. But so yeah, that happened. There was a gentleman confronting me after I got out of the fire. He kind of stepped into my space. I punch him. He kind of like bucked up on me. I punch him in the moment. He falls to the ground. I get tackled from the side by another gentleman. I feel about three people on me. I'm not sure. My wife said there was a couple dudes on me. I push myself back up. We wrestle around a little bit. There's a scuffle. It's just real intense. So then one gentleman's like, okay. And then we start calming down. Everything starts calming down a little bit. But there's a lot of tension, obviously, at this point. The cops get threatened to be called, and we don't want to deal with the cops, obviously, on a reservation type of situation. And we didn't really want any of this to
get just to wanted the point to leave.
Gotten to. Yeah, we really wanted to leave. But they didn't want us to drive on a high dose of mushrooms. So they had a point as well in that aspect, but we really just had to get out of there.
But you're like, hey, dude,
this is demonic.
If I stay here,
I don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah.
I didn't know what was going to happen that night. We had to leave. So we get in the car and we start driving. They're kind of guiding us out to make sure we're not going to like just drive off the side of a cliff or something. And that whole altercation didn't necessarily sobered us up enough to be able to drive home. But still, that whole ride home felt like we were trying to drive out of a portal. Like,
how long was your drive
from hell? It was about an hour or 2 hours. It's hard to say because it felt like 7 hours.
Yeah, it felt like eternity.
It felt like forever. Like, that was the worst part of the trip. I was like, we're never going to make it home. And all the streets looked the same in this area. It was like this windy, like very like trees hovering over the nature overriding the road. It was just intense and overwhelming. And it's the pitch black of night. It's like 3:30 in the morning, of course. A weird hour, too. You know, and I was super into like synchronicity.
Yeah, like the witching hour.
Yeah, exactly. We got into the car at exactly that hour to drive home.
I feel like regardless of whether or not people believe in like angel numbers or any of that stuff, like, nothing good happens at 3:30 in the morning.
Oh yeah, no, definitely.
Unless it's at an Orthodox church.
Right? Yeah, unless you're like doing a night vigil.
Exactly. But 3:30 in the morning driving on mushrooms, like nothing good's going to happen.
Yeah, no. And you could feel that. And check this out. I haven't even mentioned this when I told the stories the other time. So we're driving home in the middle of the night. We didn't cut anyone off. There's no one on the road, right? And we're coming by maybe Poway out of the Indian reservation territory. We're coming into like Poway area, and out of nowhere, this truck comes and he's trying to pull us over, and he's like trying to like yelling something. I don't know if he had a gun or what. It was so weird. We're not hallucinating. This is 100% real. Trying to get us to pull over. I'm like, we're not pulling. I was like, don't pull over, whatever.
You're like on the edge of the reservation.
We're just coming out of the reservation and we're crossing through Poway area back, trying to get back to El Cajon.
Well,
and it's the pitch black middle of the night. And there's this dude, he's like a white dude with like a baseball cap, like looking super proper in the middle of the night, trying to attack us. I was like, dude, that's like a demon infecting someone trying to like chase us. I could feel it. It was so weird. And it felt like he was trying to kill us. It was, and I was like, do not stop the car. So we just kept driving.
Who knows how long he'd been following you?
Dude, it was weird. And he pulled up and he was next to us and he was like yelling. And I was like, we don't have a flat tire or anything. And it was, I don't know where he came from. I don't even see him at the ceremony at all. I don't even think he was from there.
Some sort of like entity or something.
I really think it was an entity that I don't know how to explain it.
Yeah.
Still weirds me out to this day, even telling that part of the story.
And your wife saw it.
My wife saw it. She was there with me, and she'll attest to it 100% that it was something demonic. Yeah.
So now you're out of the reservation.
We're out of the reservation.
This crazy guy's
like trying to kill us for no reason. And we just keep going. We keep going and we make it home eventually. And the sun's rising just as we're coming home. I'm like, oh my God, it's just like, I was so happy to get home.
Honestly,
to my two
children. Was probably like a beautiful moment.
It was so beautiful in that moment. And I was like, I never want to do mushrooms ever again. And I never did. And shortly after that, it was like Kotel, like Church of Eternal Logos, was almost just placed like right in front of me, like providentially. Just because I was really into Dakota Wint, right? I was into Dakota of Earth. And who's friends with Dakota of Earth? Your mate Tom. And then your mate Tom's on Hotel. I think I saw, I had been introduced to it before then, but that one really struck a chord with me because it was directly like, oh, that's what I experienced. And someone else experienced it too. And
yeah, okay. same here. I've experienced the same kind of thing. Luckily, I was with friends, but it was still a very dark experience. Like, you know, at one point they weren't my friends. They were demons trying to attack me. And then it came to the point where they were like, we're going to leave you here.
Wow.
You know, we're not, you're losing your mind. We're going to leave you here. And I just like sat at my friend's house for like a whole day, just tripping.
Just losing your mind, right?
Yeah. And also, I'll tell you something real. Well, actually, you continue, because I'll tell you a crazy experience I had.
Well, honestly, if you want to go, honestly, I'd love to hear.
Okay.
That was kind of like the end of that moment. Honestly,
that was your coming to God moment.
Yeah, and just seeing the synchronicities, because I was very into synchronicities, but I now call it God's providence.
Yeah.
You know, and I love the way that David Patrick Harry explains that, just breaking those things down. Coming from a new age perspective and then breaking it down. No, this is real. And there's seeds of truth here, but here's the culmination of this in Orthodoxy, and it's God's providence.
Yeah. And we do have a Greek word, synergia, you know, like, we do believe in synergy, but that's when you and God are working together, not God trying with you and you working against him.
Like, not the Carl Jung type of synchronicity. Like, that's not what I'm, because I used to be very into that, but no, that's not what I'm talking about.
Yeah. It's kind of interesting that we've all experienced similar things that led us here. And it's amazing how many people are coming to the church. And there's also still like this, and I pray for these people, there's this group of people who are leaving New Age and they're becoming like born again Christians. And they don't realize the deception in like,
they're just into another layer of it. Yeah.
Exactly.
And the thing was,
it's better, but is it?
Yeah. I actually went through that even during that whole time. Like when I went out to, that experience, when I went through that ceremony, I was going to like a Baptist church.
Yeah.
But that shows how like that faith wasn't really, it wasn't real.
It didn't keep you from doing those things.
From doing that. You know, it didn't keep me from wearing a crystal around my neck. My priest should have said something. Or he wasn't a priest, he was a pastor. He should have said something to me. You know, what the heck you got on your neck, boy?
Yeah.
You know, but he didn't do that. You know,
it's true.
An Orthodox priest would probably have to say something to you. I mean, like, hey, bro, get that out of here.
They don't allow like things like the evil eye when you're being baptized.
Exactly.
And
that's a weird one.
That's a weird one, because some Orthodox people I know, like in the East, maybe more like, I don't know the exact region, but I've seen people online that are Orthodox that have the evil eye on them.
Right.
And either they might have been born Orthodox or converted, but I don't think they understand like what they're actually wearing. There's a lot of things that people don't even understand what they're doing. That's how cunning one is. It's like, you don't even realize it.
Yeah.
At all.
It's
like
it's
the little crystal, it may seem innocent, but what are your intentions with it? Are you wearing it just because you like rocks and crystals? Cool.
It's so tricky, because it's like, you can go like acupuncture, a lot of people may think, and then you're all of a sudden you're into Reiki healing and crystal healing. It's like one step away, like one little, you know, Pilates, yoga, like it's like, it's very close. And it's like, where do we draw the line? I don't know. And it's hard to find where the line. That's what I've been trying to, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
but I don't do any now, coming from yoga, I don't do anything. I just stretch. I do my stretching. I do my shadow boxing. I don't delve into any of that. I don't need that. What I can do is prostrations. And that's a beautiful thing. I can say the Jesus prayer. I can breathe in, say, Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God. And I can breathe out and say, have mercy upon me, a sinner.
Yeah.
Boom. That's all I need. I don't need yoga.
No. It's something that it's something I struggled with, but I know my wife struggled with, you know, like, I guess, breaking the cycle of doing yoga, because she loved it. And I know why she loved it. She was good at it. It was good for her body. I don't think she was doing it for any of the negative reasons, but when you go to a yoga class, the energy in a yoga class, regardless of why you there, there's something there. And the people that most of the people, I'm not speaking for everybody, but a lot of like, especially the guys that go there, they're going to pick up chicks.
Oh yeah.
They're going to boost their ego. Like,
there's a lot of open like sexual energy in that whole scene, dude. It's like, it's creepy.
Oh, when the guy yoga teacher's pushing the like,
yeah,
like,
exactly.
Like oh, so you got to stretch deeper.
We went to this, I can't remember what it was called. It was like this water therapy thing for like ice. You can do it like an ice bath thing. And we were there, and there was like a breathing exercise where you're doing these deep breathing, like and you put a blindfold on, and someone comes around and they're like touching your like your shoulder. I was like, what the heck is going on? Yeah. I don't want nobody touching me while I'm blindfolded. And like,
I'm good on
you
that.
Got some lady in the back moaning. It was too much, too much going on.
But dude, that's how you open your heart chakra, bro.
Right? Yeah. No, but it's crazy. Like those are the kind of things that happen. It's very telling.
They're like, you need to let go. Just open your heart. It's like, not anymore, dude.
No, it's weird. I don't know you. I'm pulled in an alley.
Yeah.
Simple.
So I had, I won't go too deep into it 'cause it's a very long story, but, and Lord forgive me for this. It was, I haven't really talked about this before at all. So it's kind of interesting. It was only brought up a few months ago by my mother. I'll shorten the story, but I was really heavy into LSD and selling it, doing it, whatever the case may be. And I was still like in a transition of coming back to live with my parents and finding a new place. I don't know how old I was, maybe 18 or 19, but I'm doing all this acid. My mom calls me on the way home from work. Hey, do you need me to pick up anything from the store? And I'm like, pick up some sweet tarts for me. So she picks up a bag of sweet tarts, brings them home. She knows I'm out of my mind on drugs. And, you know, she's trying to do the best she can to like, to help me and support me and also not, you know, encourage me to do these things. But I'm sitting there. She brings me these sweet tarts. She has her office across the hallway from me. I'm in my room. I have a Visine dropper full of LSD. I'm dosing all the sweet tarts, and from touching it, from just working with it, I'm like fried out of my mind. So I go to smoke a cigarette. I come back. I notice some sweet tarts are gone.
Oh no.
Yeah. So me not being the man I am now, and I'm already tripping, I already know what's happening. I say, hey mom, did you eat some candy off my desk? Oh yes. Yeah, honey. What's wrong with that? I just leave.
Oh man.
I just left. And because I'm like peaking, like it's not a good time for me to hear this. And I can't bring myself. It's like, I couldn't bring myself to like snap out of it and try to help the situation. So I leave. I think like the girl I was with at the time comes with me. A friend picks me up down the street. We go get a Slurpee from 7-Eleven. You know, like I'm trying to just make everything normal again. I go pick up my other friend, and he's like, something's wrong. What's wrong? I'm like, I'm pretty sure my mom just ate like a bunch of my acid. So he's like, drop me off. I don't want to be.
He's like, no, I'm going back home.
Yeah. He's like, I don't want to. And I remember him, like I picked him up and he's eating this fudgesicle. And I'm like, all I can see is this like fudgesicle, like melting over and over. Like,
right.
You know, it wasn't melting, but all I just kept seeing.
You're in this loop, like a thought loop, dude, right?
It was horrible.
Like going home, I was caught in that thought loop.
It's horrible.
It felt like we were driving in circles. It was hellish.
And it's like, I try to make light of these things. It's a very serious situation, and I've repented.
Yeah.
I've repented for it, and I'll continue to repent for it. But just so people know, I'm not like laughing at the situation. I'm just like kind of laughing at how stupid I was.
Right. Right. You know? And I can relate. Yeah. I can relate, not like laughing at you, but laughing.
No.
Like I've been there, dude. Like I've been there, bro. 100%. And I know.
So we drop my friend off. We're making all of our runs around the neighborhood, going to people's house to smoke, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm just like, not in the mood for it. And my dad calls me. He's 25 years in the military. And he's like, your mom's having a heart attack.
Oh, wow.
What was on that candy? And of course, at the time, I lied and I said, my friend did it. My friend came over and must have brought some drugs and, you know, thought I'd be okay with it, et cetera, et cetera. Now they know, like without me even telling them, they know the truth now, like many, many years later. But yeah, my mom, she had a heart attack. My dad was pissed. The cops tried to get involved. One of my friends who I actually got the LSD from in the first place, we end up at his house. He's like, you got to go to the hospital, dude. He's like, he was like the only one who was like, you need to man up and go to the hospital. Cause like the cops had called me, the hospital called me, cause they're trying to figure out what's in her. Why is she freaking out? Cause you know, if you don't know you're taking a hallucinogen, your body thinks it's been poisoned.
Right.
So her body and her brain and her heart went into this. I've been poisoned. I'm dying. She said
like
she's
shock mode. Right. Yeah.
And she said she thought she was dying.
Wow. You know,
so this all happens. I don't go to the hospital. I just, this is another thing that's weird. Like I guess you could say like the clairvoyance that I had or the demonic forces that were working with me.
Totally.
Were kind of like telling me, it's weird. I don't know. I still can't navigate this. Like I knew my mom was going to be okay.
Yeah.
I knew I didn't need to go. I knew she'd be okay. So 3 a.m. rolls around. I'm at this party, this house party. Everybody's like snorting drugs, doing all this stuff. And this is the weirdest part. This girl, her name I'll leave out, but she had a parrot. And this parrot, this parrot's name was Bubba. This is all real. This is a whole
parrot named Bubba, dude. It's so crazy the worlds that you can end up in.
Yeah, and it's sitting on my lap or on my shoulder, and I'm completely gone. Everybody's trying to get me to party, blah 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 blah, and I'm just like, boom. I'm not there. I'm not where they're at. They have no idea. They know what happened, but they don't know how I'm feeling. I can't explain it to them. You know, like, dude, my mom might be dead.
Right.
So this parrot is on me. I'm out of my mind. 3 o'clock in the morning rolls around. My mom calls me and she says, I love you. Good night. And that was it. That was it.
Wow.
Yeah. And the rest of the night I went back to eating more drugs, smoking more weed.
Right.
And it was like never even talked about until me and my wife were over at my parents' house, I don't know, maybe 6 months ago, maybe a little longer. But it came up kind of like jokingly, or I think we were watching something on YouTube about psychedelics. My mom's chronically ill. She's been sick my whole life. So like, and I don't have any family in the States. So like, this was like heartbreaking to me. Like right. if I had lost her, I would have nobody. So we were watching some show or whatever. And I think my dad or my mom's like, remember that one time? I'm like, oh, I remember that one time.
All right.
So yeah, like shows how powerful, how much of a slave you become to that stuff. Like you couldn't, even in that situation, I couldn't man up and be like, this is wrong. I need to fix this situation. I ran away from the situation.
Right.
Because I was scared of, you know, the reality I have put myself in. Like, you know, I didn't want to face my consequences. And now, yeah, it's something I have to live with. And, you know, glory to God. And, you know, my mom's still here and she forgives me. And I mean, it wasn't my intention, but it just shows when you get involved with that type of crowd and you're just like careless and reckless with hallucinogens, like what happened to you.
Yeah.
Like you go from doing a microdose. Exactly. You go from a microdose where it's like, oh, I'm learning about this. And I'm just kind of like navigating through this realm. That's this beautiful realm. And then you like go too far and you're like,
yeah.
And that was
like it went from microdosing on nature walks, like, oh yeah, so let's pick some herbs over here. Let's pick some mort and go astral travel later, you know. Yeah. And then all of a sudden, like I can't get my soul back into my body, you know. Yep. It's like,
so yeah, I've been there, man. I've been there. I've done peyote, mescaline, DMT. I've done it all, and
yeah,
there was always this thing inside of me where I was pretty good at, as small as I am and as skinny as I am, I was like really good at handling. Like I could do a lot more than my bigger friends. And they're like, are you good? I'm like, yeah, I'm fine.
Right.
But I realize now, like, man, that stuff was really, really bad for my soul. It led me to a whole nother life path that was almost impossible to get out of. But God was still there. Like, just like waiting for me to kind of repent from it and realize, you know, like God doesn't put something in your life that you can't overcome. And that's what I've kind of realized about it. So yeah, that's my little story. So I'm sure that the haters will love knowing that about me.
that was a very interesting story. Yeah. And that was really cool.
Yeah. It was like probably like 30 hits of acid.
Mother.
Yeah.
Wow.
I mean, I wasn't like drip. I wasn't like one drop.
So she probably took 30 hits.
Maybe more.
Is what you're... Wow.
It wasn't like intense. A drop. I've never done sweetheart. It was like,
wow. So I've never done acid personally. I never did acid. I did San Pedro. I was getting into, you know, things of that nature. I was doing what was I doing? I was just getting deep into herbalism, and nothing against herbalism. I'm still into it.
Yeah.
But I was going down a darker path with like wormwood and making these meads with like a lot of wormwood, and I would put mushrooms in there and I would get a little crazy with it. So
there's nothing wrong with herbs and using them for certain
things. No, not at all. Not at all. No, I'm still into herbalism. Totally. Like using things like yarrow and ginger, and there's aspects that are really healing, like making your own tinctures if you really know what you're doing. Like,
I'm trying to think of the word, but the Orthodox community, there's a lot of homesteaders, and there's right. a lot of I can't think of the word, but yeah, like,
well, they sell, I mean, from Mount Athos you can buy tinctures. You can buy tinctures from Mount Athos. You can, I mean, Saint Paisios was deep into herbs. Yeah, you know.
So there's nothing wrong with it, but once again, just like wearing a crystal necklace,
be careful.
What's
be
the intention?
Careful, like the careful with the mugwort too, you know.
Yeah. True. So yeah, that was like, my little story I've never shared, but ultimately, like you said, I'm very grateful for the experiences. And I didn't live in an area. I lived in St. Louis and New Orleans, and I wasn't in the best area. There was I mean, God, now that I know, God is everywhere, but at that time I didn't even know. I didn't know. So, okay. So enough about my little story. I just wanted to share because I've never shared that before. And your story
made
me want to open up about it. So you've had this demonic trip.
Yeah.
You come home, you're with your kids, your wife, you realize I'm done. What happens next?
So I'm just kind of like, I'm just taking it all in. I'm really had a lot to take in there. I didn't know what to make of it at first. I was still kind of caught in the new age. When I first got back, I was still kind of wrapped up in it and trying to like justify it from that vantage point, from the vantage of still being wrapped up in the new age. And
like you needed
slowly,
it.
Yeah. Like, so, and then I even went to some sermons at a Protestant church that I felt like were speaking to me at the time. But I came to knowing that it was just it's like business church, kind of like Jay Dyer calls it, you know. Yeah. It was like a bunch of guys trying to sell me something. I was like, what are they trying to sell me? Why do they all have Nikes on? I don't know.
Like prosperity preachers?
Yeah, pretty much. And I was just like, there were certain aspects, and there's a lot of people there that are good. There's some good people in that community, you know, and a lot of them have never heard of something like Orthodoxy. A lot of them just don't know what Orthodoxy is. I really believe that. There's so many people that have never heard of it that I talk to online, offline. They'll be like, what is that? What's that cross? What is that?
What are you,
like,
Russian?
Are you Russian? Yeah, right. And I'm like, no. But
you're like, is it going to make you upset if I say yes? Because yes.
Right.
But yeah, I've told people when I was working at this job that I recently got let go of, I would tell people I'm Orthodox. They're like, oh, you're Jewish.
Right. Oh yeah. That's the only type of Orthodox they've heard of is Orthodox Jews.
I'm like, you know what? I'm not even going to defend myself anymore.
Like, I'll just
sure. Shabbat Shalom. I don't know. Yeah. Whatever.
That's great. That's awesome.
So no, you realize like, that's it. You start going to like these.
And I start attending church and I find a local parish. Okay. So let's take it a step at a time. So I was attending a Protestant church. I was attending that for a while. And then I just started like, we were going to Bible studies there, and this thing keeps coming up, faith versus works. And I'm like, man, I read the book of James and it said faith without works is dead, and faith and works work hand in hand, and they're inseparable.
Yeah. The solas. And
And it was like this, it's this interesting thing where they're sola scriptura, but they don't like the book of James. Like Martin Luther wanted the book of James removed from the Bible.
Yep.
Because just because of that little part, I believe
it contradicts contradicts their whole faith.
It directly contradicts it. And you have to have some like weird Jedi mind tricks going on to justify it. Cause I was talking to people, I was talking to some of these pastors and I was like, so what about this? And they'd be like, oh, watch, I'm going to explain it. And they would just give me the runaround and say nothing and never really confront it. And I was like, I was like, what was that? I even asked my wife. I was like, did they even really answer that question? And she was like, no, he just kept talking in circles and never really confronted it. And I was like, huh, that's interesting, you know? And we just over time, we both started kind of like seeing these things. And all during this time, I'm watching Kotel. I'm watching Church of Eternal Logos. I'm starting to watch Father Josiah Trenum.
Beautiful.
And he's talking about rock and sand. And I'm like, oh man, is this a foundation of sand or rock? And, you know, we're called to be the pillar of truth. Like, what am I standing on here with this Protestantism, with this, or even if it's called non-denominational, right? But it's really just the charismatic movement. And they're really just Protestants just trying to be non-denominational. But it all really goes back 500 years. And they'll tell you they're preaching about Martin Luther and he's a good guy. And it's like, dude, that dude was a heretic who ran away with a nun from a convent. Like, come on, guys.
People don't even, but they don't want to hear that.
Right. Yeah.
Just focus on the Bible.
right? Yeah. And I don't want to be too harsh because I mean, I was just one of those people, it's interesting. It's definitely a denial of something that's kind of like right in front of your face. Once you start studying the church history, you can't unsee it. No. I don't see how you can study church history and not become Orthodox as a Christian.
Yeah. You know, I mean, there's people that leave the faith that were like born. And I think sometimes that's the issue. People that were cradle Orthodox, they have a lot of respect for converts because they're like, oh, it's so beautiful how much you love the church. And a lot of them have fallen away. I know. I mean, there's like stories of people who were Orthodox becoming Buddhists. And I'm like, how do you do that?
I was talking to Jerry from Exposing Powerful Lies. And I was like, wait, people fall away from Orthodox. Like, I was so like mind blown. I was like, how does that happen? I was like, I couldn't even wrap my head around it.
The devil's putting in work, man.
It's crazy to me because I've never seen a more fulfilling representation of truth, purity, everything I've ever looked for in spirituality, religion, whatever, Christianity, the fulfillment of that is in Orthodoxy. 100%.
That's what it's hard to tell people because they're just like, oh, you're Christian. There can't be any mystical ritual. There can't
right?
be.
But
can't,
I wasn't Christian, you know?
You can't have
I
all
was
this.
A Kundalini yogi.
Yeah.
I was like yogied out.
You're like, trust me, I know.
Like I've been there everywhere except Christianity is what I wanted to do. And I delved into it as far as I could go till I saw the demons. And I was like, hey, the demons are real.
This is real.
So what's on the other side of that fence?
Yeah. It's spiritual warfare.
Real, right. Once I know the spiritual warfare is real, it was 100% put in front of my face with that Womkish. And then also,
which side do you choose?
The pandemic going on. And so, dude, then it's like, oh man, it's really putting things into perspective. Wow, we are all in the midst of spiritual warfare, whether you're in the Womkish or not. You know, this is real. This is happening all around us, everywhere.
I still can't discern the whole pandemic thing, whether or not it's done more good or more bad spiritually for people. I feel like it's woken a lot of people up. It's exposed a lot of stuff.
Right.
But it's also like you can look at both sides and be like, oh, it's done a lot. A lot of people have come to the church. I mean, hundreds and hundreds of people are being baptized Orthodox. But you're also like, you look at the other side and you're like, people are completely denying the fact that there's man and woman and that little boys can be little girls and little girls can be little boys. It's like, I can't really tell. Are we heading in a good direction or are we like falling really, really far off? So it's like, I'm having a hard time discerning what's really going on, but it woke me up.
Yeah.
I was like a Trumper. I was like a Trumper, a QAnon person, you know, and there's a lot of good that comes from certain things. But then I started realizing I'm worshiping a politician.
Yeah. No, I was into the Trump thing at first too. I was going to they were shutting down beaches in San Diego. I'm like, I was just mad they were shutting down beaches.
Exactly.
How are you going to shut down a beach in San Diego? How are you going to shut down nature? I mean, I'll still get mad about that. I was out there like hopping over the fence, like, look at me, I'm at the bay.
Yeah.
Trying to show people, just be like, hey, you can go. Cop going to tackle me for swimming in the ocean?
They arrested that one guy.
Oh yeah, they did. He was doing like, there was like a yogi guy doing yoga on the, he got arrested
on the paddleboard. He's like out there by himself. They're like concerned about everybody's safety. Like he's spreading some disease.
Right. It's madness. Yeah. The logic in that it really didn't add up.
Well, there is none.
Yeah, there was none. The thing with Trump was he presented himself. He didn't blatantly say he was against the vaccines, but he implied. I got to watch my language here.
That's
but
fine.
He implied that he was against that at the beginning and then became a salesman for the same thing at the end.
Money.
And it makes sense. It makes sense when you really know.
That's a great sales tactic.
It's a politician, you know?
It's a great sales tactic. You're like,
he never was an outsider coming against these people. He's always been part of the group that we're not part of, you know?
Yeah. So with the pandemic, did it give you an opportunity to kind of find Orthodoxy?
Oh, dude, it totally gave me an opportunity to really delve into a lot of Orthodox literature, reading the spiritual struggle from Elder Paisios, who's Saint Paisios, but on the book back then it's Elder.
Yep.
Had the and just delving into Father Seraphim Rose, tons of his work. I had a lot of time to really sit and pray and work on my prayer life, and got myself a prayer book, you know, the Orthodox travel edition from Rome Press, and just
this little one.
It's this the, one. Let, right the, I got the, it right the, next to me, actually.
Oh, little, nice. Perfect.
Little bad boy right here, right?
That's a good one. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I like that one. And I've just been have my little humble prayer corner and I've had a lot of time to really sit and contemplate and piece these things together throughout all these experiences that I've been describing. And it really comes together the more I read and the more I delve into Orthodoxy, yep. The more all this makes sense, you know, and it all happened for a reason. And God was trying to show me something the whole time.
And a lot of things that something else is that's hard is when you find the truth, which another thing that the truth is a who and not a what.
Exactly.
Know? But people, it's hard, and I'm guilty of this myself. It's like hard to not be prideful. And we still have to remember, just like we say in the liturgy, like we're the chief mm-hmm. of all sinners. It's exactly. like we have this truth, but how we disperse it and how we share it is truly what shows if we're Christians or not.
100%.
You can really throw people off.
Yeah, that's something I need to work on myself, is my pride, honestly. I'll be upfront 100%. I have issues with my pride.
Well, it's our New Age background.
Yeah.
Where it's like all right? about the ego. It's funny. They're like, you need to lose your ego. But in order to lose your ego, you need to have the biggest ego.
Right. Right.
Doesn't make any sense at all.
Yeah. And it doesn't make sense. It totally collapses upon itself. And that's like the foundation of sand versus a foundation of rock, which I found with Orthodoxy. And like Father Josiah Trenum has been so key in bringing me out of even that other layer of the onion of lies, I like to call it. It's like an onion with all these little deceptions. Yep. And I came out of New Age into another layer through Protestantism. And it's like, the way he broke it down, because he was a Protestant pastor, if I'm not mistaken.
Like, Presbyterian, maybe?
Yeah, yeah. He has like a lot of experience. Like he went to years and years of college.
Yeah, seminary, I think, for it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So hearing him in his breakdown, I highly recommend anybody coming out of Protestantism who's even curious about Orthodoxy, dude, check out Father Joe Tranum, his talks, especially on the Rock and Sand interview. And
I
believe that's a book he wrote as well.
It is. I can throw the links in there. Also, like Jonathan Pageau. Yeah.
And oh, God, love Jonathan Pageau, too.
Yeah, I mean, I like Lord of Spirits. I'm not sure if you listen to any Lord of Spirits.
I don't know if I've listened to that.
Oh,
I might have.
Uh-oh.
Listening to a lot.
It's
but I don't know if I've listened to that.
Father Stephen DeYoung and Father Andrew Damick. It's ancient faith, and I won't go into like some of the aspects that I don't like about, but Lord of Spirits is, if you like Pageau, and if you like symbolism and like learning about, you know, like deep stuff, it's pretty cool. Like they do like astrology versus astronomy and how it's okay for us to believe in astronomy, but we don't follow the stars.
Exactly.
They don't determine your life, you know.
But when you get into herbalism, it's interesting how it links up with the moon cycles and all that stuff.
Of course, like the Farmer's Almanac, like when to plant things. But I mean, who created all that? Of course,
God. Yeah,
exactly.
No, it's good to know. You have to know the parameters.
Yeah.
There's parameters here.
Or you
right?
go too far one way, or you go too far one way.
You can go, and it's really easy to fall off track in certain areas. Herbalism could be one of them. And it's, you know, it's just good to have a spiritual father to talk to.
Exactly.
About these things.
Yeah. That'll go at the beginning of the video. I'm not sure if you saw the new warning I have.
Yeah. I've seen that.
Yeah.
I need to get myself one of those.
Dude, I'll send you one. If you,
right?
Because people are like, people
don't listen
so,
to me. Don't listen to me.
Why would you?
Go talk to a priest, please. Yeah, I'm just coming out. Like I was just doing 15 grams of mushrooms like in 2021. So don't listen to me. Right? I haven't even been baptized. I have a lot of work to do. I have a ton of work to do. And that's what I'm trying to do as I'm trying to do that work, do that inner work. Before
It's a lifelong journey. That's what's so beautiful about Orthodoxy. So you're reading the books, you're watching the videos, and shout out to everybody that's helped both of us on our journey. We have a lot of similar people who have helped. With your wife, was she open to it as much as you, or did you kind of take the lead?
At first, no, I took the lead, but I read online too. I was kind of looking at that tends to be a common theme.
Well, not to like put gender roles on thing, which I do believe there's gender roles for a reason in certain aspects, but it's like,
healthy.
we're supposed to be the spiritual leader of the household.
Mm-hmm.
And
I truly believe that. I truly believe that.
That's not a bad thing.
No, that's not a bad
thing. We'd be nothing without our wives.
I would probably be homeless right now.
Exactly. Literally. So it's like, if we can take that first step,
talking to myself on like mushrooms, probably, who knows? Who knows where I can be? I saw a glimpse of that night. I saw a glimpse of my future, of what I could become. And I was like, I would see those people wandering in the streets talking to themselves. I'm like, how they become like that?
Easy.
It's like doing way too many of these mushrooms.
Or just doing it once.
Yeah, even once.
Some people lose their mind one time.
Yeah. LSD. It could be one time.
Yeah. Dude. Yeah. I got very lucky. I mean, I'm not the sharpest tool in the shed, but yeah. I got pretty dang lucky. So your wife wasn't as sure about it. So how did you figure this out?
I just kind of, you know what? I went online and I was watching some videos and listening to, there was some spiritual elder and he was talking about, I can't remember exactly who it was, but it was really good advice. And he was saying, if your wife's not receptive to it, just stay patient. And I kept attending the Protestant church with her. I was like, you know, I'm going to stay patient. And I think she'll see it eventually. And I'll just keep recommending and playing in the background.
See what? That this isn't the place to be?
That this is not the place.
Okay.
Yeah, that the Protestantism is not the place to be. Like, that she'll see what I'm seeing. Like, because I was starting to see, like, this is not it. Like, they're trying to sell me something and I'm just not buying it. This whole faith first works thing. Like, these, I know these things are, like, intertwined and they work together. Like, I've
exactly.
Read the scripture. I know that. So it's like, you can't separate these things. And
it says it right there.
Yeah, I use this emotional manipulation and, like, I could just sense all of it. And coming to, oh, we're going to do an altar call, but it's not an altar. It's a stage and there's a bunch of lights. And I was like, man. And
Fog machine, and disco ball.
Yeah, right. And I was like, and I was playing. In the background at home, I would play Father Josiah Trenum. I just play it kind of loud and we'd go and I just kind of like, and eventually I think these ideas started like clicking.
Yeah.
I think it just started, it's a matter of time. And we started going to these life groups and like Bible studies and things of that nature. And even more so you start seeing the kind of the flaky nature and the wish. Well,
the shallowness.
Some of it. Like, and there's a lot of shallowness. And there's also this talk of like seasons. We're going through this season and I'm going through that season. And right now I'm doing this season. And it provides like an area
an
for a lot of wishy-washiness to not commit, to not be rock solid. Like we're called to be in the
it's
faith.
Like, it's like Mercury in retrograde.
Right. Yeah.
Like these things are happening because of the stars and the moons and my Mercury's in retrograde. It's like, no, these things are bad because you're worshiping demons.
Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, my wife wasn't like, she definitely was not against it at all. She had just lost three very important people in her life, her brother, her grandfather, and her best friend. So she was, I think she was looking for something to have more meaning. And like you said, I think I only went maybe like five times without her. I think maybe less, maybe more. And then I think if people can see that you're serious about it and they can see the change in you, they're like, okay, maybe I'll check it out. And I think for us, that was kind of it.
Yeah.
So you went to an Orthodox church.
So the first time I went with my wife, she did come with me.
Wow. Beautiful.
She wanted to come with me at that point. And, she was pretty receptive. It was just, there was definitely a struggle with both of us kind of coming out of Protestantism and like, we were under emotional manipulation and it was hard to come to that realization. Sometimes it's hard to admit, oh, I'm being emotionally manipulated right now. And I think that was just a big part of it. Like being able to admit that to ourselves and move.
That's the great thing about Orthodoxy is like, you can recognize when something's, it's easier to recognize those things.
Yeah. It puts the passions into perspective. And I'm like, oh, this is very passion driven and like the charismatic aspects that I see falling out of certain aspects, it really puts it into perspective when you start learning what it really is supposed to be, what worship and what it's supposed to be like when you see it in an Orthodox church, and then it's just totally different. You could feel the holiness. You know you're supposed to be respectful. There's not going to be somebody in the back with a tambourine like, you know what I'm saying? There's not going to be that. You know what I mean?
Unfortunately, no, I'm just kidding.
Right. But
sometimes it'd be nice to have a little guitar solo in the liturgy. No,
right?
No,
no, no. We have a beautiful choir at St. Anthony's Antiochian.
Wow.
At St. Anthony's Antiochian Orthodox Church, a beautiful choir.
Glory to God.
Yeah. Glory to God for the choir. It's amazing. So we started going there. I've been talking to Father John. We just became catechumen. We're going to our catechumen class tomorrow. Cool. Our first one.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and we're going to a vigil outside of Planned Parenthood tomorrow as well. So we got a busy day.
That's something we'll get into that in a second. That'll be our topic because I know you have a story about that too. If you got time.
Yeah, I do. I have time for that as well.
Cool. So like I wish that we would do more. Maybe I just need to take initiative because I know my church feels the same way I do about that situation. But I think maybe I just need to take initiative and I would like to do some of those things. It's beautiful.
Yeah, no, it was a beautiful experience. It was so powerful that the first one that we attended a few Saturdays ago, And
you what was feel the reaction?
Spiritual warfare. There's definitely some people that drive by and flip you off, and there's going to be people. There was also a Protestant group that's a little bit more aggressive, and they've been toning it down.
Like you're going to hell.
Kind of, yeah. Like the signs that are just like trying to shame people.
God hates fags. Those type of people.
Yeah, pretty much. But when I was there, apparently they had toned it down a little bit from the week before.
Good.
From the previous.
Yeah, that's not going to get your message across.
Yeah, no, and it almost like makes us look bad because people can't tell the difference. Like, I mean, you could tell if you know.
Is your priest there?
It was being led by a priest, a local priest who's friends with Father John.
Cool.
Another Orthodox priest. Yeah.
Cool.
So it was being led by him. You could definitely feel the tension. There's people driving close to some of the people that are like near the road. Like you could feel people like screeching out, and the spiritual warfare is real. But it makes it that much more powerful, and just kneeling out there praying and
oh wow,
yeah, we're out there kneeling on the cement.
And, have you seen the videos of like right now with the whole Roe versus Wade thing? There's the Catholics are being targeted, which is very unfortunate because you know, like there's a lot right? of very yeah. devout Catholics and they love the Mother of God and they're totally. very pro-life, and you know they're doing the same thing. They're doing like the Hail Mary outside of churches, and they're having fake blood thrown on in them. And
wow.
Yeah,
that's crazy.
It's just because people don't know about Orthodoxy.
Yeah.
Like I was worried about my church and then I realized nobody knows about my church.
Yeah.
Like I don't have to protect my church. I mean, I do, but you know what I mean? It's like nobody's going to come storming in. Hopefully, I pray to God because right. I don't know if how I would react. I've been watching some videos about how to react and, you know, try to catch it before it happens. Make sure that the,
I would probably use some jujitsu. I've taken some jujitsu. That's pretty good at like kind of, I mean, you know, you can kind of like not use too much aggression, put someone
you could
in
just
a
hold
hold
them
and kind of
call
restrain
the cops.
Them and just be like, okay, it's okay. It's really kind of quiet.
It's okay. You know? It's okay. Go to sleep.
It's okay. Go to sleep now.
Well, we have to make sure like the Catholics, their tabernacles have been getting stolen with the consecrated gifts in them. And it's like something wow. that,
that's
I was watching is like, we need to make sure that our holy gifts are safe because they, yeah. This group called Ruth sent us. I'm not sure if you've seen anything of that.
I have. I've seen some of, I saw yeah. three channel, Instagram, through
yep.
your Instagram page.
Yep. They're basically saying
yeah,
they're going to burn the Eucharist.
Yeah. I saw them making a picture of, I think it was, they thought it was Mary, but I think it was actually a saint, a different saint of a woman. They're saying something sacrilegious towards
oh,
Mary.
Oh, Saint Holga.
Totally. Yeah. And they were saying something blasphemous. Something.
Did,
it was
did
very,
you see the comments?
I did.
Pray,
I did.
Saint Olga, pray for us, our mother and protector, and
yeah, yeah.
People like
a lot of
didn't work out too well.
No, not having it. Yeah,
yeah. Well, that's beautiful that you're doing it. I guess that so you're becoming you're a catechumen. You're going to classes. They're a lot of fun. Another thing that people don't realize is that like even though I'm, I guess technically kind of newly illumined, I'm still a catechumen.
Right.
Forever.
Right.
You know, I'll always be learning. And that's, I think it's so awesome. Like, I don't know. I know nothing.
Yeah.
Don't well, let I mean, the icons fool you. I know nothing, yeah. you know,
I've got so much to learn. And it's just, that's the beauty of Orthodoxy is it's so deep. And it's like, it's so rich, yeah. so deep, spiritually rich, not like, you know, this financial materialistic richness, but a spiritual richness that I've never seen in any other type of spirituality. I mean, like the first time I attended St. Anthony's Antiochian church, I got to sit down with an elder and he was telling me about someone in his family who got their arm severed in from the Turkish situation where the Turks came in and took over Constantinople.
Yep.
He was talking like way back, crazy history, Orthodox history, and it was just so beautiful to be able to sit down and share a meal and talk with someone like that. And he had this massive intense Orthodox cross on his chest, and it was just, he was such a cool dude, so
epic.
Respectable
one
so
day.
Humble. Right. And I was just really humbled to be able to sit and speak with him for the period of time that I was with my wife.
Yeah, there's a grace that exists within the Orthodox Church like nothing else I've ever experienced. So I think it's crazy.
I agree.
So with the whole Roe versus Wade and kind of we were kind of leading into like you know, that whole movement. I know you have one child or two? Two.
I have two children. Yeah. I have my son Malachi, who's 8 years old, and then I have my daughter Maya, who is 4 years
beautiful.
Old. So Malachi Rocky Ratelle, Maya Aurora.
Hey,
Ratelle.
Nice. I like it. I like it. So being a father, and I have a 6 year old son, and you know, me and my wife plan on having kids of our own when the Lord allows. I'm not happy with what's going on.
Yeah.
You know, it's really pretty disgusting. So I know you have a story about how things could have been differently for you if you had chosen that path, or if your wife and you had chosen that path. So yeah, if you want to share a little bit about that.
Yeah. A few years ago, back in like 2017-ish, my wife was pregnant with our second child. We did not know she was pregnant. She was born with a specific disease, an illness, and she has issues with her liver due to it. And there was a fluid buildup in her. She basically has stage 4 liver disease, to put it into some sort of perspective, without getting into too much details, but she was born with it. And there was a fluid buildup in her stomach, which caused her to go into labor very premature with our daughter Maya or Ratelle. And she was given a 10% chance of living by the doctors. So they were really trying to push
a 10% chance of living.
Yeah, that's what they told us. They told us that she has like a 10%, that the chances of her surviving if she goes forward with the pregnancy were really low. That's what they were. It felt like they were really pushing.
Is that the one that I hear screaming?
That is the one you hear screaming in the background right now.
Love it. Yeah. It's not loud. I love it. Hey, there's proof of life right there.
Exactly. Yeah. So we were going to these appointments, getting checked out, and everyone around us. She's working at a salon at the time. We're living in North Park, which is very kind of liberal. Like right down the street, they have the Pride Parade. Just to put that into perspective, what kind of area we're living in at the time. So she's working at a salon. We're in North Park, Pride Parade down the street. Everyone around us, you need to abort. You already have a child. You already have a family. Why would you risk losing your whole family in this to have one more child? And da 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 da, putting all these doubts and these thoughts in our head. And we felt like we had nowhere to turn. And we didn't know about the Orthodox Church at the time. We were, this is years ago. I was still in the New Age, deep into that. But I did know about
appreciated
Christ.
The sanctity of life.
Yeah, I appreciated the sanctity of life, and I still had some root of the Holy Spirit, I think, in me from just my Catholic upbringing and my mother praying. And I have family members that do pray devoutly still. And so anyways, we're moving forward with that. And I'm just like, I can't, there's no way that I can abort my child. There's no way I can murder my child. I know what this is. I know this is murder. It's not a fetus. This is a life. This is my unborn child. This is my unborn daughter. And she wasn't having it either, but it was a terrifying situation. It was a terrifying conclusion to come to, that like when someone's telling you only have a 10% chance of living and you're risking everything, you know, to have your daughter, to do what you feel is right, to do what you feel is righteous. And there was a moment, you know, I was sitting with her in the hospital, and it came real fast. They just rushed her in. They kind of said we were going to have a certain amount of time beforehand, like an hour or two. And they just rushed her in, kind of came in like something had happened on the monitors. They knew they needed to get her in there right then and there. Yes. So it was real quick. And I'm just kind of left in the hospital room. I went into the waiting room and I came back into the hospital room because I just wanted to be by myself. And I was praying to Jesus Christ. And I knew in that moment, even though I was in the yoga and all these other things, I didn't call out to Shiva. I didn't call out to the Dalai Lama.
Thank God.
In that moment when, yeah, thank God I didn't, because who knows what would happen. But in that moment, I knew I had to call out to Christ. It was weird. I was broken. It was like this broken desperation. And I called out to Christ, and I felt the Holy Spirit in my heart let me know that my wife was going to survive, that we were going to be okay. There was this reassurance in my heart that I cannot explain. And it wasn't like the Blue Pearl experience. It was a totally different experience. And There was a voice in my heart, not an audible voice, but it spoke to my heart, and it let me know you're doing the right thing, and I'm here with you, and I'm gonna guide you guys through this, basically. And my wife ended up surviving. She ended up surviving, and my beautiful daughter was born. She was born 2 months premature. She was 2 pounds 4 ounces, but she survived. Wow. She went to NICU, and we stuck there with her, and. Stayed nurturing her for months on end, and she was finally able to come home.
She was in NICU for months.
Yeah, it's hard to really piece all that
together. A long time.
It felt like a month and a half.
You didn't get to go home with your baby girl right away.
No, we didn't get to go. It felt like forever. It feels like forever when your child's in the NICU.
Yeah. Because you're going home and sleeping and coming back.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And we were there. We were very on top of it because, I mean, it was a very personal situation to us. And I mean, obviously it's our child, but even more so with everybody telling us to kill our child and no, we're not gonna, you know, you learn to appreciate life even more. It puts life into perspective. And that's how I came. That was the beginning of me coming back to Christianity. Yeah. After that, I still went out to do my nonsense. I fell away, but I felt like that night, when I jumped into the fire, it was like God reminding me of the promise I made that night to him. Like, what are you doing? Like,
yeah, this dude.
You know what I mean? Like, this is, I gave you your child. You know what I mean? I gave you this and I made a promise to him that night and I was reminded and I hope I never forget again, you know, and I don't plan on it anytime soon. I have no interest in the new age anymore. I have a lot of interest in helping people out of the new age.
Yeah.
Because of my experience in it. And I think that is the place that I can find in this world and in this aspect of talking to people online is one thing I do know is the new age. I know orthodoxy slightly. I'm coming into it. I'm still new. But I know the new age like the back of my hand.
Yeah.
And I want to help other people out of it.
Yeah, it's beautiful. I think it's not an easy task, I'll tell you that, because
right?
That's like...
Yeah.
That's like the worst one to be sucked into. I think it's, you know, like I'm not dogging anybody, but I think getting out of the new age is harder than getting out of, you know, any form of Christianity. But I, like I said earlier, people are seeming to understand like it's all a lie.
Yeah.
It's one big deception after another.
Whole pandemic aspect. It's like everything that went on with that. I think it's waking a lot of people up.
Yeah.
Even in the new age, there's people that all agree at least with on certain aspects of that. You know what I mean? In that range, we can agree on certain things, but then the ultimate truth gets lost, which is a shame because it's the ultimate truth and there is no getting around it. And
yeah.
The truth is a who, not a what.
Exactly.
It really is.
It's hard to explain to people. They're like, what's the truth? And I had somebody ask me that recently when we had to do our Paschal service and our Holy Week services at a Catholic church because a fire almost burned down our parish.
Oh yeah, I saw that.
Holy Week, yeah.
I
had somebody come up to me, some homeless guy, and he was like, "Hey, do you mind if I come in? I'm looking for the truth and I want to know what the truth is." And I said, "Well, I could tell you one thing and it might not make any sense to you, but the truth is a who, and if you want to come inside and, you know, sit there quietly, you can't receive the sacraments or any of those things." But he came in, this guy, homeless, filthy, but such a pure heart. And he sat in the back the whole time, stood up when it was time to stand up. 3 hours he sat there. He came up and he prostrated in front of the cross.
Wow. Like,
it was beautiful just to see that people are, it's sad, people are lost, but it's beautiful to see that orthodoxy is starting to gain, I don't like to use the word traction, but it's starting to arise here in the West. And I think it's, you know, like NPR just posted that article.
I know. I saw
about,
that.
About the Russian Orthodox Church. And it's like, okay, so the target's on, the target's, it's like good and bad. We got a target on our back now, but now it's our job to show people what the truth is. And my friend Ian John, me and him talk a lot on Instagram and whatnot. He was saying, he posted something funny the other day, like Orthodoxy de-radicalized me. He's like, for any journalists that are following my page, it de-radicalized me.
Me too. Me too, 100%. I was really radical with the, you know, I don't like labels. I'm not going to label myself because the whole the whole far right thing can get a little, it can get tricky.
Yeah.
It can get tricky out there. What I've learned is to stay away from politics because really there is no political answer to these problems you're seeing in the world. There's a spiritual answer.
Yeah.
And it's orthodoxy and it's Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. It really is. And it may take, I hope it doesn't take people going through what I went through to realize that. Hopefully they can live vicariously through my story and hear and connect some dots and talk to some people and go visit a parish for yourself. Go visit an Orthodox church for yourself and speak to the priest and see what you feel in your heart and take some time to pray and really do. There is work to do in that regard, but it's so worth it.
It is.
It's so worth it in the end if you really come at it with a genuine heart.
Yeah, there's like this weird little quote. It's like, well, work is work, but it's well worth it. You know, it's like, yeah. Well, it's work. People are like, oh, that's going to suck. I'm like, well, work is work, but it's going to be worth it. It's like, you have to just get past that. Like, you know, as the New Age likes to say, you have to play with your shadows or whatever the heck, your shadow self. Yeah,
that is nonsense, right? It's like welcoming demons into you.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. We just need to like, you know, accept the shadow in your shadow self. And that's like, that sounds like a demon. Like,
it's how would you recognize him?
That sounds like what people see when they smoke too much meth and stay up for 5 days, like shadow people.
Like, yeah, it's
I don't
like
need that
how about
in my
you
life.
Recognize the shadow and work on it, not work with it. You
it's
know,
like how about I come to orthodoxy? And like, you know,
yeah,
don't do any of that.
Well, Mark, I think maybe for like part one, or you know, I would love to do more. I had a great time.
Yeah.
Talking to you.
This was awesome. This was awesome, dude.
I think it gives people a perspective, especially coming from two people like us. You know, we're definitely not, we've been through a lot.
We're not the typical Christians, I guess, whatever that means, you know,
as far as society is concerned, you know what I mean?
Right. And I think that is a good thing to some extent. And it can help other people hopefully relate and see that, hey, we're normal folks that have been through the same stuff that a lot of people are going through currently right now, delving into. And, you know, it doesn't lead anywhere good. The way I was going, it wasn't leading anywhere good. It led me to a pit of fire, swan diving into it, belly and first. That's literally where it led me.
And I tried to, I mean, I haven't done any psychedelics or drugs since being baptized, or even like, I think prior to being a catechumen, I like took a hit of a joint again. And I knew I was going to hate it.
Yeah.
Like, I absolutely knew I was going to hate it. And I hit it. And I was like, I hate the way I feel right now. And I had to like, you know, tell my now spiritual father, like, hey, I did this as like a test. He's like, well, that's kind of a stupid test. But I was like, I hate it. I'll never do it again. You know what I mean?
Right. So it's a video that I felt was really powerful in that regard was the Father Spirit and Bailey one.
Yep. The marijuana one.
I'm surprised there's not more videos like that, but I'm happy he put it out because it needs to be confronted because it gets overlooked. And I think a lot of people, it's so innocent. It doesn't even need to be confronted or it doesn't need to be cut out. Some people don't think they don't need to cut it out because they can do it and seem normal. And maybe other people don't notice. And maybe they think it's not affecting them in a negative way. But I mean, Father Josiah Trenum and him both on that subject.
Amazing.
Really, I highly recommend.
Yeah, well, I'll put some links. If you have any that helped you, send them away, and I'll drop them in the description.
For sure.
And I'll make sure to put your stuff in there because you've been doing some videos, which are I like too. So I think you should.
And
I'm
gonna be up in the quality here soon too. So there will be some better visual quality and audio, and I'll be getting a mic and some better lighting as well.
And
so.
don't just like from some advice from me. Don't listen to what people say.
Right. Yeah. It's hard. It's hard not to read those YouTube comments.
Cause you're a catechumen. You shouldn't be doing this. You shouldn't be that. If you get a blessing, if you have a blessing, do it.
Right.
You know, it's like, people are like, oh, you're a catechumen. You shouldn't do this. You need to be quiet for 5 years or 10 years. Is now the time to be quiet? I don't think so.
Right.
I think we should preface with, I'm not clergy. I don't know anything, but I'm going to share my experiences and share what I know. Cause now I don't think is the time to be silent about our faith and about the issues going on in the world. You know, we're called to be both salt and light. I think there's a balance, and it's hard to find sometimes. Sometimes you overdo it on one end and not on the other. And, you know,
most definitely.
So don't listen to what people say, man. As long as you got the blessing of your priest, your spiritual father, or, you know, I don't think you're really even getting into thing that you're, I think most of your videos you're like reading.
Yeah. I'm mostly when I talk about orthodoxy and the theology, I'm reading from like a saint.
Yeah.
That's what I like to do because it's like, what does my opinion really matter on that? I'll tell you my opinion on New Age. Don't do it. It's the oldest lie in the book, dude. New Age, oldest lie in the book, in the Bible, dude. It's like, you could trace it right back to Genesis. I remember coming back from that experience and reading Genesis and like, how did I miss this?
I like that. New Age, the oldest lie in the book.
Yeah.
That might be the title.
It might. That's a good title. It's a good title, man.
So do you have anything else? If not, we can wrap up with a prayer, if you don't mind.
Yeah, no, we can definitely wrap it at this point. I think we covered all bases.
There was always something afterwards that I realized we didn't talk
about. I'll look back and I'll be like, dang it, I forgot that. But I actually remembered a couple moments that I haven't remembered in the past telling this story, like that moment of the gentleman and chasing us and through the night. So that was cool.
Good. I'm glad it.
And I really like that St. Patrick prayer that you did recently. Like, I bind. It almost reminds me of the craft, but like Orthodox Christian.
Yep.
I know that's a weird reference.
I know what you mean. But it's
like, it's almost like it's a powerful prayer.
It's really powerful. It's like using it.
Yeah. Like binding yourself away from evil, from, you know what I mean? Yep. And it's powerful when you hear it, because he fought against all that paganism in Ireland, and I'm Irish, and I was getting deep into my Celtic roots. Yeah, the serpents.
Have you thought about a name
for
your baptismal? Have you thought St. Patrick's a good
one? I haven't.
My son is.
That was my father's name. My father's name was Patrick.
Really?
Yeah. R.I.P. Rest in peace. Yeah.
Oh, really? Sorry to hear that, man. Yeah.
Yeah. No worries.
My son was born on St. Patrick's Day, so he's also baptized as Patrick. So,
okay,
and it's
awesome.
It's a good one for kids, especially. Like, it's good for them to have. Like, that's like a great saint to learn about as a child. You know what I mean? It's like it gives you a lot of stories and stuff.
Especially if you have someone in your family with the New Age background like we do, because he drove the pagans out of Ireland. The way he fought that was just really powerful.
They're coming back though.
Oh yeah, no, it's repeating itself in cycles, man.
It's a revival. The pagan revival is, and I just went and saw The Northman. And it kind of shows what real paganism is.
It looks like
is.
A good flick. It looks like an interesting flick. I want to check it out.
It kind of lifted the veil. It's like Hollywood lifted the veil on what paganism really is. It's like they didn't water it down as much, and it's like, this is what you guys want to come back,
right?
Like, really?
I want to check that out. Yeah, you should.
It's good. Bring a prayer rope.
Yeah, no, I've got it all times, dude. I don't take it off. I sleep with it and everything. Good. Like, it doesn't.
Yeah, it was a good movie. But we'll end with a prayer if you don't mind.
No, I don't mind at all, brother. All right,
perfect. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. O Heavenly King, O Comforter, the Spirit of Truth, who art in all places and fill us all things, treasury of good things and giver of life, come and dwell in us and cleanse us from every stain and save our souls, O gracious Lord. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. All Holy Trinity, have mercy on us. Lord, cleanse us from our sins. Master, pardon our iniquities. Holy God, visit and heal our infirmities for thy name's sake. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, both now and ever, and to the ages of ages. Amen.
Amen.
And for my Catholic brothers out there, I'm going to do a quick Hail Mary. So, you know, they're going through a lot. Hail Mary, Hail Mary, full of grace. The Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus Christ. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Amen, brother.
So, hey, good one.
Yeah, that was good, dude. That was awesome. I really enjoyed that. And it was a pleasure to know you, because we haven't really spoken until here, which is kind of cool sometimes to leave it. Because then it's raw, and it's like we're really meeting for the first time on air. And that's really what it
sometimes was. I'll talk to somebody like how we had talked for a few minutes, and then I'm like, all right, hold on, let's press record, because we're already getting into the conversation. Yeah. Well, thank you, Mark. I appreciate your time. Make sure that you guys look at his videos. His videos are awesome. I love what you're doing. I think it's beautiful. I think we need more people that aren't afraid to share their journey. And yeah, I look forward to posting this video, and I hope that you have a blessed day, and that the Lord guides you and your family. And I'll be praying for you. I'll add you to my nightly commemoration, which is something I need to do. So, yeah, man, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen, brother. Truly, thank you so much for having me on. I'm truly humbled by this whole experience and opportunity. And I just feel blessed to be here. So good. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Well, glory to God for all things. So
glory to God, brother.
I'm just a little pawn in this machine or whatever. All right, man. Well, hey, thank you. God bless. And I'll talk to you soon.
Glory to God, brother.